difficult to explain why I like SpongeBob, because everybody likes SpongeBob. Professional wrestling is a bit of a different story. When I say names like Ric Flair, Randy Savage, Hulk Hogan, and Andre the Giant, most of you can probably picture a vague figure in your heads, but you can't specifically tell who I'm talking about. Why is this? Well, the answer is, professional wrestling is one of the most popular and unpopular forms of entertainment on Earth. Professional wrestling fosters the capacity for emotional storytelling that can compel an arena of stoic adults to jump out of their seats and scream like little kids.
Sunset flip!
Don't believe me? Well, then you probably haven't watched an episode of Monday Night Raw. But Amp, a lot of you are probably thinking, professional wrestling isn't real. You must be too dumb to realize that. I am smarter than you because I know that professional wrestling is fake. Aw man, you got me. Professional wrestling is not, in fact, a real athletic competition.
There's is that Bautista? Wait, was he actually a wrestler before? Yeah. Oh my god, I had no idea, dude. What the fuck? That's sick. How do you not know that? Dude, I literally just got acquainted with wrestling, like, last week, okay?
No getting around that. Guess I have to end the video here because pro wrestling isn't real.
Real to me,
it's still real to me, dammit!
But neither is Star Wars, or the Avengers, or Goku, or Homer Simpson, or any character in Super Smash Bros. None of these things are real. However, it doesn't stop people from talking about them far more than they do a lot of real things. And in order to truly appreciate the rhetorical value of pro wrestling, you must treat it as it really is. A work of fiction. But not just any fiction. Pro wrestling is one of the last remaining bastions of theater. Now, like a lot of you, I went to public school.
Yeah, but not gay. Like, not gay theater, it's ungay. There's nothing gay about it. Do not tell me that men dressing up in scantily clad outfits as their pectorals glisten in the hot summer Monday Night Raw light. They touch one another and caress one another lovingly as they dance out through their opera show. You better not tell me that shit's gay. You understand me?
Where many of you can probably remember multiple times in English class when you had to learn about this guy called Bill Shakespeare, considered by many scholars to be the greatest playwright of all time. And for so many years, I didn't get the appeal. I don't think anyone else did either. The only types of people in school who actually seemed to care about Shakespeare were the future MIT grad who memorized every piece of trivia ever, or the-
Wait, they fucking set up an event in North Korea? Dude, what is happening? How did I not know anything about wrestling? It is literally like, it is one of the greatest franchises of all time. It is like so insanely entertaining. It's got all of the fucking worst shit of like American culture jam-packed into one incredibly watchable event.
1 year.
I love wrestling so much. It's so fucking good, dude.
The kid who was way too...
Are you joking? No, I'm not even remotely kidding when I say this to you. Like, every fucking part of wrestling is so entertaining. They held a wrestling match for Saddam Hussein. I love it, dude. It's literally America, dude. It is America captured. It's the very essence of America bottled, captured, viled, sealed, and sold back to American hogs. Like, every part of it is a demonstration of some of our worst and subsequently some of our best content.
The theater. I never realized the value of Shakespeare until I discovered the treasure trove of old pro wrestling clips on YouTube.
And after we take Lex Luger and the Giant, we want the gold, sucker, Hulk Hogan, we coming for you, then.
Okay, this is epic.
And only then did I realize why people love Shakespeare. Reading Shakespeare in 7th grade English is so boring because the content is not meant to be consumed through words on paper. Shakespearean plays flourished during a time before the majority of people knew how to read. Playwrights and actors had to craft compelling narrative performances using the limited tools they had. If you boil it down, the genre of theater mostly involves a bunch of weird people in stupid costumes prancing around and over-embellishing in iambic pentameter. Theatrical entertainment doesn't come from what's literally happening on stage. The value of theater comes from filling in the blanks using our imagination. This fundamental principle is otherwise known as the suspension of disbelief. It's why when you see this image, your brain doesn't automatically interpret it as some guy called Mark Hamill holding a blue stick. When you see this image, you see Luke Skywalker holding a lightsaber, neither of which are actually real. Suspension of disbelief allows us to accept beyond—
Why does every fucking person want me to check LSF today? What the fuck happened on LSF today? Well, I don't understand why you're like, dude, check LSF, it's popping. Check LSF. Oh. Doc has no clue who Hasan is. That's why. Okay, let's keep going.
On what's literally happening on screen. It allows us to experience a story and its characters as real, no matter how simple the presentation. This same principle applies to novels, comic books, musical lyrics, cartoons, movies, and yes, professional wrestling. Visual storytelling is an inherently human art form, and people have been performing stories for audiences for thousands of years, dating all the way back to the earliest known auditoriums of ancient Greece.
Wrestling is more than just red-blooded American. El Santo. El Santo was literally a Mexican Superman and meant a lot for our culture. Okay, first of all, it might have meant a lot for your culture, but I'm gonna keep it real with you. I feel like even the representation of Mexicans in American wrestling are incredibly Americentric. Okay? Or at least as far as what I've seen from the Latino wrestlers that I have seen so far in their plot lines, which include like, you know, being a deadbeat dad and then fighting for, you know, the custody of a child or getting hunted by Border Patrol. I feel like Mexican wrestling is, you know, luchadores are a big deal separately. But from what I've seen, it's like, it's just fucking content. I look at it like an anthropologist studying and understanding like an ancient civilization. You know what I mean? You know it's true.
Greece, where citizens would gather around and listen to an esteemed orator recite the works of Homer.
I'm so angry I could spit flames out of my butt.
Homer Simpson versus Lisa Simpson.
It should go without saying that the 1990s in America were very different from 6th century BC Greece. 3,000 years ago, people really didn't have that much stuff to drown out the entertainment value of a guy standing on a platform and just talking to the audience. The 1990s was the birth of a new era of screens.
You must become a student of wrestling. You will understand how stereotyping did more harm than good when Booker T was being portrayed as a royal in 2006 is what changed the game.
Television, video games, huge blockbuster movies, even the beginning of the World Wide Web. The new millennium was rapidly approaching, and everyone was preparing for the futuristic, technocratic, utopian future of the 2000s by surrounding themselves with the newest, coolest gadgets of the age. You'd expect that all these new entertainment sources wouldn't leave much room for little old theater, and you'd probably be right if it weren't for professional wrestling.
Bro, I'm sorry, you can't tell me wrestling is not fucking problematic or whatever when Triple H exists, okay? AKA Triple K. Holy shit, dude. Everything I've seen of this dude is horrible, okay? In the best ways possible, I mean, I'm still gonna watch it. You can't stop me. I'm going to watch it. But also, at the same time, he's literally just a fucking horrible person. Beyond just, like, playing out a role, I feel like he's just, like, a bad dude, okay? Oh, my God. Oh, my fucking God.
From about 1996 to 2001, professional wrestling became one of the most inescapable cornerstones of American entertainment. And in order to understand why, we must first talk about a guy by the name of Vince McMahon. Vince McMahon started out with nothing. He was trapped in a dirt-poor household with an abusive stepfather. Today, he's worth about $3.5 billion, which is a little bit more than Donald Trump. It should be noted that this disparity hasn't prevented the two from being friends, which is the primary reason why Vince's wife Linda is currently in the executive cabinet of the United States. Perhaps Vince and Donald are such good friends.
Uh-oh, Nicki Minaj quote tweeted him. Anyway, let's just keep going.
Because they have so much in common. The two billionaires were born just 10 months apart. Both got rich not through a groundbreaking invention, but through ruthless business acumen. Both of them started a rival football league to the NFL that ultimately failed, and both of them built empires by transforming businesses that they inherited from their fathers. In Vince McMahon's case, he reunited with his father, Vince McMahon, Sr., at the age of 12. Vince Sr. owned the Worldwide Wrestling Federation, and Vince took a managerial position at the company.
Perhaps the most phenomenal athlete of all time, standing to my right, the one and only Andre the Giant, heads up one-on-one.
By the mid-1980s, Vince Sr. had passed away and Vince McMahon was now in charge of a booming wrestling empire. Over the past decade, McMahon had completely overhauled the territorial system of the pro wrestling industry and transformed the WWF into a nationally recognized brand. In the 80s, the WWF experienced their first great boom period. Vince's ambitious business ventures like WrestleMania brought professional wrestling into the American pay-per-view market and transformed stars like Hulk Hogan into national icons. The WWF's huge success in the late 80s quickly began to recede in the early 90s, however. This was due to a multitude of reasons, ranging from a waning audience, Hulk Hogan departing for Hollywood, and a massive steroid controversy that almost sent Vince to prison. Coupled with other failed experiments such as the World Bodybuilding Federation, it's safe to say that by 1993, Vince was in dire need.
Is this dude like a Trump supporter? I don't get it. You said Emp Lemon can't go one video without mentioning Trump? Like, I don't understand.
A new enterprise. It was at this time when Vince decided to transition the WWF into a staple of cable television through the debut of Monday Night Raw.
Welcome everyone to Monday Night Raw! We are live from New York City, Manhattan Center. I'm Vince McMahon, along with the Macho Man Randy Savage, Bobby Heenan.
Ever since the popularization of the television in American society, professional wrestling has...
We're going to watch Wrestling Isn't Wrestling after this. That's a good video too, apparently.
...always had its place on TV, but never to the extent of what Monday Night Raw sought to accomplish. Prior to Raw, the primary role of wrestling on TV was to stimulate interest for live shows or pay-per-views. Wrestling programming at this time was supplemental, and mostly involved recapping old events or promoting new ones. You would hardly ever see any high-profile or interesting wrestling matches televised during this time, as the intrigue was reserved for more important events. Monday Night Raw changed all of that by broadcasting new matches and progressing the story every Monday night on the US.
No, don't give Max Landis clout. Who is Max Landis? How am I giving him clout? Why have you created this thing in your mind where, like, I'm giving this person, like, you're freaking out over a person I don't know who the fuck they are, and you're like, who's Max Landis? Is this a setup to be like, Max landing my dick in your mouth or something? Is that what you're gonna fucking say? What does Max Landis have to do with anything? Why?
Say Network. Before Raw...
Why are people so hysterical whenever things happen that I am oblivious to?
Pro wrestling was limited in its storytelling capabilities, as most of the time the audience would only be aware of the narrative and characters through a handful of pay-per-view events each year. Raw greatly expanded the capacity for storytelling in the WWF, as the audience could now tune into new developments on a weekly basis. The foundation had been set for one of the most innovative and unique television programs in the world, but it would take an entirely separate force to truly take Raw to the next level. Today, the WWF is now the WWE, and it's the only major wrestling promotion in America. In the 90s, however, there was another. WCW was a wrestling promotion largely based in the South, and by the 1990s, it was the only major wrestling promotion in America that Vince had failed to conquer. The company was largely helped by the endorsement of media mogul Ted Turner, a longtime wrestling fan who supported WCW by airing its programming on the Turner family of networks.
In the early
90s, WCW quickly became a popular alternative to the WWF, due in large part to signing some of the WWF's older and more established talent. In 1995, a Turner Network executive by the name of Eric Bischoff decided the time was right to challenge the WWF's throne as the number one wrestling company in America. On September 4th, 1995, WCW would launch Monday Nitro, their own weekly block of wrestling entertainment on TNT. Nitro would go on to compete head-to-head with Raw, occupying the same primetime time slot. And starting in 1996, Nitro would overtake Raw in television viewership, beginning an 84-week-long streak of WCW dominance. In the midst of Nitro's prolonged period of success over Raw, Vince McMahon knew that his company was now in jeopardy. More and more of the WWF's high-end talent were jumping ship to WCW, leaving Raw stuck with a cast of unpopular and unproven faces. So when faced with such stiff competition, Vince did what any other monarch would do when his empire is threatened. Go to war.
You want to go to war? You want a war? You're going to get one.
It has been said that anything can happen here in the World Wrestling Federation, but now more than ever, truer words.
So Vince McMahon's entire fucking shtick revolves around, I mean, other than like, you know, identifying all of the really interesting parts, I'll just say, interesting parts of American culture, and turning it into fucking content, all the way from date rape to racism and, you know, really harmful stereotypes. But then on top of that, he was just like very good at fucking monopolizing the space. Is that what happened? Meanwhile, motherfuckers are talking about Max landing on someone's, you know, Max landing a dick in someone's ass when they should be like, why are you platforming Vince McMahon? Sorry, you can't watch anything. The creator's brother's neighbor is racist.
Words have never been spoken.
You don't see knives, you don't see guns, you don't see rapes, you don't see anything at all like that that's portrayed in anything that we do. It's a very...
Just mentioning someone isn't platforming, I don't get it. Do words mean nothing? Yes. Yes. Words mean absolutely nothing. Yes. Context means absolutely nothing. Okay? People lose their fucking shit. For no reason.
Very wholesome, family-oriented environment.
WWF wrestling in the 80s and early 90s was largely a reflection of American culture at the time. It had a deceptively sanitized exterior of traditional family values that was masking a grotesque underbelly of steroids, cocaine, and painkillers. You had the bleached blonde hero Hulk Hogan patriotically leg-dropping America's nefarious foreign adversaries. By the mid-90s, a lot of people in America began to see through the facade, which gave rise to a huge movement of counterculture. All of a sudden, you had the American hero Hulk Hogan dyeing his beard black, smoking cigars, and beating up good guys on WCW, and people loved it. Vince could see the tide of American culture turning, and he knew that if he wanted to save his empire, he was going to have to get edgy. What transpired was one of the most awe-inspiring 2 years in the history of American television. With Monday Night Raw and WCW Nitro constantly trying to outdo each other for a share of the American TV audience.
Steve, is a dead man walking?
I feel like Attitude Era, judging by what I've seen thus far of Attitude Era, was just literally cranking a dial of like bigotry and being like, is this working? Yeah. Would you like to see more of that? Would you like to see more of that? Which, by the way, great content. Don't misunderstand me. I just like, I see that. And I understand why they did that.
Because when Austin 316 meets Pillman,
oh my God.
9mm clock.
Yeah.
Imagine if Seinfeld and Friends were both trying to put each other out of business as members of each cast would constantly swap back and forth between each show. This is what it must have been like to watch professional wrestling during this era. I could list off a compilation of all the outrageous and incredible events that were transpiring between these companies on a weekly basis, but
when I was younger, I used to jerk off to the Hulk Hogan sex tape. That is the most embarrassing thing that anyone has ever said in my fucking chat. We are literally worse off for knowing about that. Why would you? Why? I often say chat will say anything. And my God, perhaps you should stop yourself.
To truly help you grasp the absolute madness.
Don't ever repeat that to people in public chatter. Do not do that.
Of this time, I only need to show you one moment from one episode of Monday Night Raw. But before you can truly know the significance of this moment, I've got some explaining to do. First and foremost, every good story needs a good protagonist. So let's talk about Mick Foley. When you picture a professional wrestler in your head, you probably don't picture a guy like Mick Foley. Mick Foley's pear-shaped physique hardly resembles the tall, chiseled muscle men that are common in the WWF. Mick Foley doesn't have the freakish size, Herculean strength, or Olympic athleticism.
Oh my God! Is he squatting two muscle-bound wrestlers on this? How is that even possible? Holy fucking shit, dude. That is an insane... Oh my God, dude. Yo, that is incredibly impressive, okay? That's not even... Like, that is the most impressive thing I've ever seen. Because that's not 600 pounds. That's like 600 pounds with the worst weight distribution possible. Like, the amount of... The weight distribution there is so bad. It's so much harder to fucking squat human beings.
To draw an audience. The reason wrestling fans watch Mick Foley is to watch him get hurt. By all measures, Mick Foley is simply not talented enough.
It's impressive until you realize it's all fake. Dog, what is fucking fake? What? Explain to me how this is fake, okay? Wrestling is fake, yes. But, like, how is that fake, dude? What do you think they're fucking floating with wires or something? Is that what you're saying? The Big Show was like 350 to 400 pounds at the time. Oh my God. Yeah, it's actually fake. They're full of helium. Yo, motherfucker's actually saying their feet are on the rope. Do you know how little weight that takes off? Are you insane? Like, even if they have both their feet on the rope, do you know how little amount of weight that is that takes off? This guy's literally wearing like JNCO jorts while squatting two gigantic dudes. He walks them around. Shut up. Someone send me the fucking... Please, someone send me the... Oh my God. Oh my God. Someone send me the video. I have to see this. Brock Cena, John Cena's...
Wow, John Cena! Double German soup!
Neither member of Legacy will let the other man get the pin.
Look at the power of Cena.
He's blocking it.
No way! No way!
Here's the double soup!
Dude, he's so awesome! Oh my God, I see why all the fucking cancer babies want to meet him, dude. What the fuck? Oh, it's so sick.
But
Dude, that's insane. That's insane. That's insane. That's insane. That's insane. That's insane.
Oh my God.
No, you gotta be kidding me. Cena had both men up.
Oh, okay. The other one jumps down. Okay, that makes sense. There's no shot. Like, there's no fucking shot. Oh my God, dude. That is so insanely impressive.
Oh my God.
Motherfuckers be like, wires, dude. Yeah, totally. Totally, dude. Bro, look at his whack-ass outfit. I can't get over this, dude. Look at this whack-ass outfit that he's wearing while he does this shit, too. That is so insane. Literally just the wackest shit you could wear. He's got the fucking... He doesn't even have regular jorts. He's got the JNCO jorts.
You gotta be kidding me! John Cena had both men up, and there's the attitude!
Oh my God, is that like a sumo wrestler? How... Wait, was that... I'm the son of the... Fucking... It's Mario Judah, dude. We know where the fuck Mario Judah is. He's floating on top of John Cena. All right, let's get back to this.
Strength or Olympic athleticism to draw an audience. The reason wrestling fans watch Mick Foley is to watch him get hurt. By all measures, Mick Foley is simply not talented enough to earn a share of the pro wrestling spotlight. To compensate for this, he sacrifices his own body through some of the most death-defying stunts the WWF has ever seen. Perhaps Mick Foley's most iconic moment came in 1998 during...
What did he do there? That's nuts.
To compensate for this, he sacrifices his own body.
Oh my God. He lost his ear? I saw the Hell in a Cell shit. That was nuts.
Body through some of the most death-defying stunts the WWF has ever seen. Perhaps Mick Foley's most iconic moment came in 1998 during the second ever Hell in a Cell match. In this match, Mick Foley is wrestling as Mankind, just one of his three different wrestling personas.
Dude, I don't understand his personas at all. They are just insane. Like, I asked you guys why he wore that mask, and you were like, because that's Mankind, dude. That's it. Like, no one was able to give me a reasonable answer as to why he was wearing that fucking mask. Like, it just, like, doesn't... Dude, man, love, kind. It just doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. Kind of like forgetting the fucking top of the hour ad break, you know what I mean? Like, just a thing that doesn't make sense, which is why I can't forget it.
Mankind is supposed to be this disfigured, gremlin-like guy who lives in the boiler room beneath the arena. He finishes off his opponents by suffocating them with a dirty sock. And he's completely insane. In this match, Mankind is fighting The Undertaker. The Undertaker is one of the most legendary and recognizable wrestlers of all time. It's difficult to get wrestling fans to agree on anything, but even the most jaded ones will act giddy upon hearing the sound of The Undertaker's iconic dong.
Oh my God! What? The dead man has risen!
So I don't understand. From the outside looking in, I don't get The Undertaker, but that's probably because, like, you know, I didn't grow up with any of this stuff. You know what I mean?
The popularity of The Undertaker is difficult to describe for anyone who's not a fan of professional wrestling, and I'm not going to try to explain it now, but maybe Justin Wang from the YouTube channel Wang can. since, you know, he kind of looks like The Undertaker.
The Undertaker is hands down the greatest character in the history of WWE. He debuts at a time when Vince is going crazy throwing all kinds of different gimmicks against the wall. Literally shares his first pay-per-view appearance with a guy in a giant turkey costume. But unlike the garbage man who for some reason also wrestles, or the plumber who for some reason also wrestles, the undead zombie who for some reason also wrestles had way more staying power. The Undertaker very quickly becomes a fan favorite and maintains that status for almost 30.
So basically, both of these experts on wrestling are stating that The Undertaker is popular because it was a repetitive bit that was beloved for some reason, and people don't know why, but... like, that's it? It was beloved for the repetition. The word is iconic.
30 years. He continually reinvents himself over the course of those 30 years and eventually becomes the unbeatable final boss of WrestleMania. Except for that time he got beaten. But it's actually kind of a good thing that he got beaten, because to pigeonhole him as the WrestleMania guy minimizes everything else that he's accomplished in his career.
Thanks, Justin. I'm not gonna get too much into The Undertaker right now because—
okay, like, this is a way sicker fit than like half the other shit that I've seen him wear,
really
though.
He doesn't really play a role in the Raw moment I'm discussing. But he was involved in Mick Foley's most recognizable moment ever by throwing Mankind off the top of the cell in front of thousands of stunned spectators. Mick Foley's 280-pound body plummeted from the height of a two-story building and splashed down on the announcer table below. No one had ever seen anything like it. The following shots of Mick Foley show medical personnel surrounding him and lifting his limp body onto a stretcher. At this point, any fan watching would have walked away completely satisfied with the effort that Mick had already put into this one stunt. About 5 minutes later, this happened.
Hell in a cell match.
Yeah, I love when motherfuckers are like, wrestling is fake. Yeah, I mean, it is, but also at the same time, like, they're doing incredibly impressive feats of strength.
Are you kidding me? He wants to go back up. Mankind is going back up.
No way. If he throws him up on the other side, there's...
Stop.
I ran out there and looked down at him, still lying in the ring where he landed. His eyes weren't rolled back in his head, but they looked totally glazed over like a dead fish's eyes.
Shortly after this, Mick Foley can be seen, somehow still conscious, sitting up in the ring corner with his tooth in his nostril. He then wrestled The Undertaker for about 10 more minutes, where he eventually got choke slammed onto a pile of thumbtacks. The Undertaker won this match, but Mick Foley, through his superhuman resilience to pain, had won the hearts of the WWF fans. Naturally, this match instantly cemented Mick Foley as a legend in the pro wrestling universe, and as a fan favorite. And even though he won the admiration of the audience, he never quite seemed like a guy who was supposed to win a lot of matches. And most importantly, never did anyone truly believe that Mick Foley could become the WWF champion. So what's the point of watching big, strong dudes throw each other off the tops of buildings? Well, the goal of both fictional wrestling and legitimate athletic competitions is to find out who is the best in the world. So you have a bunch of wrestlers fight each other, and some of them win more than others. And only then do the winningest wrestlers have an opportunity to fight for the WWF Championship. Becoming the champion is not just the ultimate goal for the characters in the storyline. It is also the ultimate sign of validation for a wrestler's real-life career.
So the part of that, like, that frustrates me a little bit is that, like, who gets to decide? And this kind of goes back to my Triple H argument, because, like, I just don't like Triple H. Maybe because he's, like, a very convincing... heel, I guess. But it's annoying that, like, writers get to be like, yeah, you're going to be the fucking loser, dog. Well, that sucks, because people think this is real. I would like my character to fucking win every now and then, you know?
The fundamental foundation of every wrestling narrative is watching guys fight to become the champion. Lower tiers of wrestlers will each fight for their own version of a championship. But no title is more coveted and more prestigious than the WWF Heavyweight Championship. Historically, the WWF title has been reserved for only the biggest, most popular attraction in the company. When you become the WWF champion, you become...
Bro, this is... What's his name? I mean... What the... This is a cop, right? You can't tell me this is not a cop. Oh my... Oh, that's a fake... Yeah. Okay, that's just fucking bullshit. I thought he was, like, picking up, like, a real shark for a second. Before I... Anyway, let's keep going.
I'm the face of the company. Usually, the championship only changes hands once, maybe twice a year. So whenever it happens, it's a pretty big deal. And on the January 4th, 1999 episode of Raw, Mankind found himself with an opportunity to win the WWF Championship. This is the essence of his hero's journey. But every hero needs a good villain. And the villain of this story just so happens to be the guy Mick Foley is facing for the championship. A man who many of you already know.
Do you smell what the Rock is cooking?
Today, The Rock is one of the most recognized Hollywood actors on the planet. Although many people would agree that he makes a much better celebrity than an actor. Most of The Rock's repertoire today involves acting in high-profile but ultimately forgettable action flicks, and Moana. The Rock's widespread fame today may raise the question of how he got popular in the first place. You see, 20 years ago, The Rock burst onto the pop culture scene as a wrestling god. To this day, no one wrestler has ever been able to hold the audience in the palm of his hand quite like The Rock could. But it wasn't always like that. In fact, when The Rock first debuted in the WWF, he was hated. The Rock didn't start off as the wisecracking, smack-talking, one-liner dropping legend that many of you know him as today. He was a bland, dopey-looking Samoan called Rocky Maivia, who would stand in the middle of the ring and smile like a goober. This was a character that may have worked 10 years prior, but not during the era of edgy 90s counterculture. WWF fans hated Rocky with a passion, and they would shower him with relentless boos while chanting "Die, Rocky, die." Eventually, it became clear that the only way for Rocky Maivia to stop getting pushed around by the crowd was to push back. And on one fateful day, The Rock was born.
I got three words.
Gross.
Die, Rocky, die. That's the gratitude I get from you pieces of crap.
Over the next 2 years, The Rock would transform into one of the most smarmy villains in the company, becoming such a good heel that, ironically, the audience had no choice but to love him. In 1998, The Rock would align himself with Vince McMahon and the corporation to cheat to win the WWF Championship, commencing his new reign as the corporate champion. In order to become the champion, Mankind would have to go through not just The Rock, but the squad of goons in Vince McMahon's corporate stable. The deck seems stacked against him. Triple H may be one of the most interesting wrestlers of all time, not for what he's done inside of the ring, but for what he's done outside of it. Triple H started off as just another no-name wrestler in the mid-90s. He is now one of the top executives in the WWE. His real-life rise to power within the company is most likely due to his marriage with Stephanie McMahon, Vince McMahon's daughter and heir to the WWE throne. I would go more into Triple H, but this video by screenwriter Max Landis explains his career better than I ever could. Triple H is the leader of a faction called D-Generation X. If you happen to be working at the Standards and Practices Department for the USA Network from 1997 to 2000, the mere mention of the letters DX will probably give you a PTSD flashback. Seemingly every week, DX would invent new ways to joke about their penises. They spent every moment on screen basically acting as raunchy as possible. They also popularized the crotch chop 10 years before Waluigi did it. One time, the members of DX rode a literal tank to the front door of WCW Nitro just to stick it to their competition. But if there's one thing Triple H and DX hated more than WCW, it's authority. Hey, wait a minute. Anyway, whenever McMahon's ruthless corporation would attack a defenseless wrestler, DX would seemingly always be there to level the playing field. And that's exactly what happened in Mankind's championship match versus The Rock. We enter a scene of utter chaos, as the audience anxiously waits on pins and needles, anticipating if Mankind can do the unthinkable and win the WWF title. And that's when they hear the all-too-familiar sound. At this moment, the roof of the arena is about to become unhinged from the surprise return of Stone Cold Steve Austin.
This dude literally got in the company saying, "Suck my dick," and then ended up fucking the CEO's daughter. I know. I just, you know, too much.
Stone Cold Steve Austin may be the most popular wrestler of all time, even more so than Hulk Hogan. But he, like many other wrestlers I've talked about here, came from humble beginnings. Stunning Steve Austin was just an average and forgettable wrestler for WCW in the mid-90s. In 1995, WCW unceremoniously fired Austin while he was out of action with an injury. But if things couldn't get bad enough for Steve, this was also the time when he went completely bald. And when a man has lost his hair, he has nothing left to lose. Steve Austin would join the WWF with a vengeance. He cultivated the anger from his WCW firing and adopted it into a Stone Cold new persona. Stone Cold Steve Austin became a pissed off redneck from Texas who would beat up everyone and everything. He was the consummate anti-hero, constantly interrupting matches to beat people up for literally no reason. These antics made him popular for sure, but he would only attain legendary stardom through his feud with Vince McMahon. Those of you unfamiliar with wrestling may have been confused earlier in this video when I mentioned that The Rock teamed up with Vince McMahon. Why is the owner of the WWF recruiting a stable of bad guys to beat up other wrestlers in his company? Well, unlike most billionaire CEOs, Vince McMahon is deeply passionate about the product he's selling. And he is willing to put his own ass in the ring and get beat up by his own employees and take a top rope frog splash from a 266-pound fat guy back in the 90s when the WWF was in serious danger of going under. Vince took it upon himself to do whatever was necessary to save his company, going so far as to abandon his casual role as a commentator and quickly transform himself into the most despicable villain in all of wrestling.
Hello, Peter. What's happening?
So I was sitting in my cubicle today and I realized ever since I started working, every single day of my life has been worse than the day before it. So that means that every single day that you see me, that's on the worst day of my life.
The 90s ushered in a period of sterile corporatization for the American worker. This was a time when most Americans had fallen out of faith with the government, but still somewhat trusted their corporate overlords. A time before companies like Enron and the big banks royally screwed up and put the world economy on a downward spiral. A time before the internet transformed the paradigm of what was thought possible for earning a paycheck. Most Americans entering the workforce at this time were left with one of one option. You would spend all your daylight hours, Monday through Friday, working in a cubicle under oppressive fluorescent lighting. And you were expected to do this week in and week out for 40 years. Naturally, a lot of workers weren't exactly thrilled with this reality. Vince McMahon must have known this because starting in 1998, he transformed himself into the living embodiment of everything Americans hated about their corporate world. And for every ounce of hatred projected on Vince, Americans found an equal amount of catharsis in watching Stone Cold Steve Austin repeatedly beat the piss out of him on national TV. The Austin McMahon feud escalated throughout the entire year, and it catapulted Austin into mainstream stardom. Steve Austin did on a weekly basis what every layperson in America wishes they could have done to their bosses, teachers, or any other oppressive authority figure. He represents something universal about the human spirit, the desire to fight back against those who control you, the constant dream of capturing your own slice of agency. Stone Cold Steve Austin is a man who cannot be controlled, because the second you try, he'll blow up your bus, fill your car with cement, and spray you with beer from a fire hose. And most importantly, he'll give the people what they want. Many wrestling historians like to point to this moment as the loudest crowd reaction in WWE history. I guess ultimately that's the whole point of all of this, to give people a window into a different world. A world where you could truly believe the unbelievable. A world where valiant heroes could overcome seemingly impossible odds, and where despicable villains would always be brought to justice. Eventually, you just had to keep watching to see it happen, and many Americans did. Even if it was just for 2 hours a week on a Monday night. Wrestling historians also like to point to this event as the moment where WWF surpassed WCW once and for all as the premier wrestling company in America. Over on TNT, the Nitro commentators intentionally spoiled the ending of that night's Raw ahead of time.
If you're even thinking about changing the channel to our competition, fans, do not. Because we understand that Mick Foley, who is going to win their world title.
This decision backfired spectacularly, as 600,000 Nitro viewers immediately changed the channel to Raw to witness one of the greatest moments in professional wrestling history. Conversely, those who kept watching Nitro that night got to witness one of the most anticlimactic and frustrating moments in wrestling history, as the despicable villain Hollywood Hogan reclaimed the WCW championship after his so-called opponent Kevin Nash literally laid down and gave it to him. 2 years later, WCW would go out of business, and Vince would finally achieve his goal of conquering the last major American wrestling promotion by acquiring WCW for pennies on the dollar. Right after the WCW commentators spoiled the end of Raw that night, Tony Schiavone infamously mocked the idea of Mankind winning the WWF title by sarcastically commenting,
"Gonna put some butts in the seat."
Technically, he was correct in his snide assessment, because no one was sitting down in the Centrum Center as the referee counted to three on Mankind's first ever championship victory. Monday Night Raw is still on the air today. WWE and wrestling as a whole have largely diminished in popularity since this time. It's a decline brought about not from what's different in the ring, but rather how the world has changed around it. And for this reason, WWE may never again be able to replicate a moment of this spectacle. But nothing else on TV really could either. The pure hype of the crowd surrounding the ring that night is something truly unique about professional wrestling. Visceral, palpitating feeling of unbridled excitement that permeates through whatever screen you're watching it on, even 20 years later. The cascading wave of emotion on display here is, quite simply, Raw. And you'd be hard-pressed to replicate something like this with any other TV show. Not bad for something that's not even real. This is the end of just another episode of Monday Night Raw. There are more than 1,300 other episodes like it, and counting. So if you find yourself bored on a Monday night flipping through channels on TV, and you happen to catch a glimpse of a bunch of weird-looking muscle men brawling on the USA Network, you can stop and appreciate it. Because there will never ever be another TV show like it.
Oh my God, no! Mankind did it! Mick Foley did it! No! Stone Cold did it! Mankind has achieved his dream and the dream of everyone else who's been told you can't do it! No! You can't do it! You can't do this!
All these daily streams, whether big or whether small.
there he is again. Hasan is dreaming. Hasan is dreaming. You wait.